Hello viewers, this is Ranjana ma'am and you are watching my channel. Yes, and your channel of course. And many of you have requested me to continue with Tempest. In class 11, the syllabus of Tempest is up till Act 3. And in Act 3, there are two scenes. So I have completed Act 2 where there are two scenes. And in Act 1 also, there are the two scenes which I have already completed. So, we'll start with Act 3. So, Act 3, Scene 1, of course, today. Ba. Before I start my tuition or my coaching or my lecture, I always ask you one thing. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't. So you must have got sick of it, but no way, I'll continue with it because subscribers mean a lot, not in the sense of money, but in the sense of satisfaction. It makes me satisfied because when I view the statistics, I find that non-subscribers are more and subscribers are less. So anyway, that is why maybe after watching you all forget to subscribe or you feel it's no need. We needed to watch it and it's done. But think of me. It inspires me, it boosts me. I feel very good. And that makes me continue further. That yes, I'm getting a positive response. No, it's not that I don't get positive response. Many of you are boosting my energy and my, what should I say, work by giving very wonderful comments. I love you all. But at the same time, these are for those who watch and forget to subscribe. Please, please, please do subscribe and press the like button. Now, without wasting any more time, let's get to work. So, Act 3, Scene 1, what is it about? In this, we find Ferdinand as the log bearer. So he has been with Prospero's magic power brought under his control. And Prospero wants to test his sincerity, his genuine, whether his love for Miranda is genuine or not. Because he really wishes that Ferdinand and Miranda should fall in love with each other. Because that would be a sweet revenge when Miranda becomes the wife of Ferdinand and as such the queen of Naples. That king of Naples who had conspired or rather joined hands with his wicked brother in the conspiracy, it will be a sweet revenge upon him. So, Act 3, Scene 1, let's see. So, Ferdinand, he is bearing a log according to the orders of Prospero. There be some sports are painful, and their labor delight in them sets off. Some kinds of baseness are nobly undergone, and most poor matters mean to rich ends. So he is carrying a log of wood. Imagine a prince who has never been accustomed to hard work, and he is carrying a log. So he says, there are some jobs which are painful. Money carrying the log is painful, but the pleasure which it gives compensates for the labor that they involve. Money in carrying a log of wood, there is pain because it's physical pain, but it gives him a pleasure and satisfaction. Why? Because he feels he's doing it for the sake of Miranda. So the pleasure as if compensates for the pain that he gets on account of the carrying of the log. Carrying of the log is a painful physical activity. But it soothes and gives pleasure to his mind. Some kinds of baseness are nobly undergone. So there are some menial jobs also which are quite noble to carry out. It may be the job of carrying a log, but it is very noble to carry out. And most poor matters point to rich ends. So some of them, they aim at very positive results. Some poor jobs also, they point to very good results, positive results. This my mean task would be as heavy to me as odious, but the mistress which I serve quickens what's dead and makes my labors pleasure. So I told you, why is he happy? Why does he get pleasure in carrying the log of wood, though it's a painful job? Is because he feels he is doing it for the sake of this beautiful lady Miranda. So he says that this labor which he is doing of carrying the logs of wood would have been very hateful to him if it had not been for the lady for whom he is undergoing all this painful and difficult job. So the labor which he is doing is not painful, but it becomes a pleasure to him because he feels he is doing it for the sake of Miranda. Oh, she is 10 times more gentle than her father is crab, and he is composed of harshness. So he is comparing the father and the daughter. Actually, he doesn't know that Prospero is not really like this. Prospero has appeared to him as a very irritating and very, short-tempered type of man, suspicious type of man. But in reality, we all know Prospero is not really like this. So he says that she is 10 times more gentle than her father is irritating and harsh. He is made up completely of harshness. I must remove some thousands of these logs and pile them up upon a sore injunction. So he has been given orders to carry several thousands of these logs and put them in a pile. And if he does is fails to do this, he will be punished. I think this is an example of hyperbole or exaggeration, because see, thousands of logs, what will Prospero do with thousands of logs? He means to say a number of them. So my sweet mistress weeps when she sees me work and says such baseness had never like executor. I forget. But these sweet thoughts do even refresh my labor's most busy list when I do it. So he is talking about Miranda. He says that my beautiful mistress, she weeps out in sympathy when she sees me engaged in such a type of menial job, such a type of labor. And she says that such a cheap job had never been executed by someone so noble as Ferdinand. And he says, oh, I have forgotten my work and I have paused to think of her. He's forgotten his work and he stopped to think of her. But he feels also, these sweet thoughts do even refresh my labors most busiest when I do. So yet he thinks that these sweet thoughts about Miranda makes his labor a light job. Meaning he doesn't feel it so much heavy. When he carries the log, it doesn't appear to be so much heavy when he thinks of Miranda. So this is what we call love. Because when he's carrying this log and thinking about her, his mind is distracted. His mind is not concentrating on the log of wood, but on Miranda. So naturally, he doesn't feel that pain. Enter Miranda and Prospero at a distance unseen. So both of them have come, but Miranda doesn't know Prospero has come. Prospero knows, but he is invisible. He is standing at a distance. He is invisible, so Miranda doesn't see him. She has come here to meet Ferdinand against the orders of her father. Her father has deliberately ordered her not to come because he knows that she will surely come here. Miranda, alas, now pray you, work not so hard. I would the lightning had burnt up those logs that you are enjoined to pile. Pray set it down and rest you. When this burns, it will weep for having wearied you. My father is hard at study. Pray now rest yourself. He is safe for these 3 hours. So she is feeling very sad that please I request you don't work so hard. She just wishes that the lightning had burnt up all the logs of wood which he has been ordered to pile up. And he says, please put it down and rest, because when this log of wood burns, it will be crying because it had exhausted you. For exhausting you, when these logs of wood are put to the fire, they will cry. And then she tells him a secret. My father is hard at study, busy at study. He won't be coming here for the next 3 hours. We are safe from him. So this is an irony. Why? Because she doesn't know, neither does Ferdinand know, but the audience knows that Prospero is there and watching everything. He must be having a hearty laugh. He must be getting amused. Ferdinand, O most dear mistress, the sun will set before I shall discharge what I must strive to do. So Ferdinand, how can he listen to her words and stop his work? Because he has been given such a work that in order to complete the work which has been given to him, he will have to work continuously till sunset without any break. No break for a Kit Kat also. So he will have to continuously go on doing the job till he finishes his work. Money till sunset he will be required to continue. No pressure. If you sit down, I'll bear your locks the while. Pray give me that. I'll carry to the pile. So now what can Miranda do? So she volunteers to carry the log of wood for him. So she says, please give that to me. I'll carry it for you. And how can a man allow that to happen? He's just because he finds it a difficult job, can he give it to Miranda to do? So he says, no, my precious creature, I'd rather crack my sinews, break my back, than you should such dishonor undergo while I sit lazy by. So no, my dearest, I cannot allow this to happen. I cannot allow you to carry the log of wood. Instead, I would allow my muscles and my back to break rather than allow you to do this job while I'm sitting and watching you lazily. No, no, no. Mane, it would be very unmanly. It would become me as well as it does you, and I should do it with much more ease, for my good will is to it and yours it is against. So Miranda gives a reason. She tells that the labor will suit me equally as it suits you. Besides, I will be able to do this job much more easily. Why? Because I have an inclination towards it. I wish to do it while you are against it. Mane, you are doing it not unwillingly. You have been ordered to do it. So naturally you are doing it unwillingly. And I would do it willingly. Why? Because I am doing it for you. So I will be doing it much more easily than you do it. So Prospero is watching and getting amused. So what does he say? Poor worm, thou art infected. This visitation shows it. My poor girl, it seems you have been infected with the bug of love. So, because your visiting Ferdinand is a clear proof of it. Miranda, you look wearily. You seem very exhausted, very tired. No, noble mistress, it is fresh morning with me when you are by at night. I do beseech you chiefly that I may set it in my prayers. What is your name? So up till now, he didn't know her name. So he called her my mistress. So now he's telling, no, my dear mistress, when you are in my company, it seems fresh night, fresh morning, even if it is night. Do you find any similarity between Merchant of Venice and this one? Remember when Bassanio had returned from from Venice to Belmont, and he had said that we would be sharing day with the antipodes. If Portia was there, that means Portia was the like the sun, illuminating the place around her. So they would be enjoying day with the antipodes, even in darkness, if Portia was by. And here Ferdinand is saying the same thing about Miranda. So I request you so that I may keep it in my prayers, like we chant the name of God. He is ready to keep the name of Miranda in his prayers. So he's asking her, what's your name? Miranda. Oh, my father, then she realizes, oh, my father had told me not to tell him my name, and I have broken the promise. I have broke your hest to say so. So she has broken Prospero's orders. Admired Miranda. Indeed, the top of admiration, worth what's dearest to the world. So Ferdinand really appreciates Miranda. Your name means one who should be admired. It means the height of admiration. So, full many a lady I have eyed with best regard, And many a time the harmony of their tongues hath into bondage brought my too diligent ear. So, being a prince, he has come in contact earlier with many women. He has seen many ladies with the greatest interest. And some of them, they spoke so sweetly that his ears were very attentive to listen to what they said. For several virtues have I liked several women. So, I have liked many different women for some different quality, one quality or the other. I have liked them. Never any with so full soul, but some defect in her did quarrel with the noblest grace she owed and put it to the foil. So, he says that never before had he been so completely in love with some woman as to as not to see the faults which she had. So she must be having some good quality which made me admire her. But the fault which she had, I did not become blind to the fault which she had. So she had some defect or the other. So in spite of having some good qualities, she had some defect. And I never became blind to those defects. Oh, you, so perfect and so peerless, are created of every creature's best. But he says that all these women, they had some virtues in them which made me feel great admiration for them. But their faults also were visible. And therefore, I was never completely possessed by any of these women. But Miranda, you seem to have all the best, all the virtues of all the women. And you don't have any flaws. You don't have any defects. You are as if perfect. You have been as if created with the best of every creature. I do not know one of my sex, no woman's face remember, save from my glass, mine own. So Miranda had come to this island when she was just 3 years old. So she is naturally... she has naturally not seen any woman in her consciousness. Mani, 3 years that time, she was quite small. And since she has come to this island, she has not seen any female other than herself. So she says, I don't know any other woman of the world. I don't remember having seen any woman's face. And I have only seen my face and that also in the mirror, which is a reflection of your face. Nor have I seen more that I may call men than you, good friend, and my dear father. So I haven't seen any man also other than my father and now you. I call you my good friend. You are one man and the other man is my father. So these are the two men whom I have seen. How features are abroad, I am skinless of. So I am unaware of how people look outside. Out of this island, how people look, I am completely unaware. But by my modesty, the jewel in my tower, I would not wish any companion in the world but you, nor can imagination form a shape besides yourself to like of. Oh my God! So at such a small meeting only, Miranda has become completely in love, has fallen completely in love with Ferdinand. And this is a type of confession. So she's telling, I'm swearing by my modesty, which is my best treasure, that I do not wish to have any companion other than you. And my imagination cannot figure someone other than you. Nor do I want to have any other companion, nor do I wish to see any other person than you. And then she says, but I prattle something too wildly and my father's precepts I therein do forget. And then suddenly she realizes, oh my God, I've been talking so much and in a loose fashion. And in doing this, I have forgotten my father's instruction. Her father has told her not to talk to this stranger. And yet she has forgotten that and she's going on talking randomly. I am in my condition a prince, Miranda. So he says, regarding my status, I am a prince and would no prince. I do think a king, I would not so. So he says, and I think I am a king. Why does he say this? Because he feels his father is dead. So in that way, he is a king also. In the absence of his father, he naturally follows to his father's crown. He follows to his father's throne, inherits it. So I am a prince and I think I am a king, though I wouldn't want it. I wouldn't wish it. Why? No one would wish the death of a father to become the king. But there were times we have seen in our Indian history also when they wanted to become the king. But no, he is not like that. And would no more endure this wooden slavery than to suffer flesh fly blow my mouth. So he says that I do not wish, since I am a prince, I do not wish to endure this type of labor of piling up the logs in the same way as I would not allow a flesh fly to trouble me by sitting on my face. Suppose what happens? A flesh fly comes and sits on my face. So what do? We drive it away. In the same way, I would have done the job, this job also, I would have reacted to it in the same way. Hear my soul speak. The very instant that I saw you, did my heart fly to your service. There resides to make me slave to it. And for your sake, am I this patient logman. So what a nice confession. He says, the moment I saw you, my heart flew away to you. And it is still residing there and it has made me a slave. And it is because of you that I am patiently doing the job of carrying the logs. Do you love me? Oh heaven, oh earth, bear witness to the sound and crown what I profess with kind event if I speak true. If hollowly in birth, what best is boded me to mischief? I, beyond all limit of what else in the world, do love, prize, honor you. So he says, oh my God, oh heaven, oh earth, all of you be witness to my confession of love which I am going to make. If I am authentic in what I am saying, reward me with something favorable. And if I am not sincere in what I am confessing, if I'm speaking a lie, then all the blessings which are in store, which you have kept in store for me, change them into curses. Punish me in as much severe way as you want. So he is asking heaven and earth to be witness to his proclamation. So I do love you, I value you, I honor you beyond the limit of whatever else exists in the world. So Miranda, naturally, she's overwhelmed with this confession. So she says, I am a fool to weep at what I'm glad of. So I should be happy and I'm a fool to weep. I'm crying instead of laughing or being happy. I'm crying at my good fortune. Prospero, fair encounter of two most rare affections. Heavens rain grace on that which breeds between them. So Prospero, this is what he had wanted. He wanted to test whether Ferdinand was genuine, authentic in his love or feelings for Miranda. And now he is invisible and he has heard the honest confession coming from Ferdinand. So he is very happy. He says it's a blessed sight, the meeting of two very rare loving hearts. And he wishes that God may bless the love which has sprouted between them. Ferdinand, wherefore weep you? So why are you crying? At mine unworthiness. Yes, again an echo of Merchant of Venice. Remember, Portia, what Bassanio had spoken about Portia was that from four corners of the world suitors had come. And she was such a rare combination of beauty and brains. And yet, when Bassanio had won the casket, she had told that, I'm satisfied with what I am, but for you, I would want to make myself 10 times, 20 times, 1,000 times more rich, more beautiful, more knowledgeable, more virtuous and all that. Remember? So here she is also saying the same thing. Rather, she can be expected because she has lived here in this isolated, God-forsaken island. But still, she had her father as a mentor. At mine unworthiness that dare not offer what I desire to give. I desire to surrender myself to you, but I feel I'm unworthy of it. I'm not worthy. So I'm really crying at my unworthiness because I feel I am not worthy of offering which I wish to offer. I wish to offer myself, but I feel I am not worthy of being your love. And much less take what I shall die to want, and still what I am dying to have, I dare not take. Why? Because I feel I am not worthy of accepting your love. But this is trifling, and still she says this is just insignificant, and all the more it seeks to hide itself, the bigger bulk it shows. The more I try to hide my love, the more powerfully it comes to the surface. Hence bashful cunning, and prompt me plain and holy innocence. So now she feels that cunning and bashfulness, you all leave me, and because I'm trying to conceal and it is coming in the forefront, so rather let me get rid of it. Let me speak to you in a simple and innocent manner. I'm your wife if you will marry me. So I'm ready to be your wife if you agree to marry me. If not, I'll die your maid. And if you do not have any intention of marrying me, if you don't wish to marry me, then I shall remain a maid, but with my heart dedicated to you. To be your fellow, you may deny me. You may refuse to accept me as your wife, but you can't stop me from being your servant. But I'll be your servant whether you will or no. So whether you accept me as your servant or not, I can always be your servant. You cannot stop me from that. Ferdinand, my mistress, dearest, and I thus humble ever. So Ferdinand says, you are my dearest mistress and I am your servant forever. My husband then? So you agree to be my husband then? Eh, with a heart as willing as bondage ever of freedom. Here is my hand. So he says, yes, yes, in the same manner as a man who is suffering slavery would want freedom, in with that eagerness, I want to become your husband. And then he puts forward his hand towards Miranda. And Miranda also puts her hand forward along with her heart, and mine with my heart in it. So yes, I am also offering you my hand, but along with it, my heart is also going out to you. And now farewell till half an hour hence. And now she wants to bid him farewell for half an hour. Ferdinand, a thousand thousand, so a thousand 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 farewells. So they leave the stage. Prospero is alone, and what is his opinion? So glad of this as they, I cannot be. So both of them, the experience which the lovers are experiencing, I cannot experience that happiness. This happiness can only be experienced by the lovers. But my rejoicing at nothing can be more. But I cannot be happy of anything as much as this. Mane, this incident has made me the happiest person. I cannot rejoice as they are rejoicing. Why? Because this joy can be experienced by the lovers. But I cannot be happy at anything more. Mane, nothing more can make me so happy as this. I'll to my book for yet supper time must I perform much business appertaining. So he says that now he will retire to his cave to go back to his magic books, and before supper time he has to perform something in order to bring his scheme to a perfection, in order to complete his plan and or scheme. He has to, some work is pending, so he wants to retire to his magic books, because before supper time this has to be done. So Act 3, Scene 1 comes to an end. It's quite a small scene. And then again, Act 3, Scene 2 is a subplot. All the three foolish fellows, I mean Trinculo, Stefano and Caliban, will be there making the plot to throw out Prospero, which will result in a failure. And this scene was Ferdinand Miranda's love story. So it's a small scene and yet it's quite important for y'all. Especially Ferdinand's scene, lines like, I am a patient log man and all that. And the first paragraph, of course, is very, very important. So I hope I have done my job of explaining it well. So wait for my next one where I'll do Act 3, Scene 2. And this will bring the Tempest syllabus of Class 11 to an end. So have a happy time. Goodbye. And don't forget.